Friday afternoon. This is the Dolores Reyes Show on elifemedia.net. And I'm your host, Dolores Reyes, and I'm joined here today with my co-host, Alice Butler Short. Say hello, Alice, to our listeners and our viewers.
Hello, everyone. So glad to be here with you this afternoon. We have a really interesting discussion lined up.
Oh, we certainly do. Well, the script has hit the fan. Hollywood with Harvey Weinstein's sexual assault allegations. Now let's get right to our question for today. Alice, start us off and read the first two questions for us.
Okay, number one, what did the Hollywood holier-than-thou left-wing nuts know about Harvey Weinstein, and when did they know it, and why did they really hide it? Let's discuss. Two, why is President Trump trying to build up our military capacity, and why are members in the deep state, Congress, and the Democrat Party trying to prevent him from doing so? Let's discuss.
Leaks around at the White House. Someone released a detailed account of the Rex Tillerson, remarks about the president. Tillerson remarks about the president to the press. Do you think Tillerson's days are numbered and his nights are few at the White House? And why? Let's discuss a few between Senator Corker and the White House. Am I saying that right? Oh, my God. And I'm going to tell you, if we have time, I'm going to tell you about my strange encounter with the play at the theater in Washington, D.C. Okay? So let's talk about, what do we want to talk about first? Harvey.
Oh, we'll get Harvey out of the way.
Let's get Harvey out of the way.
Yes.
Okay, let's get Harvey out of the way. Now, I've got a few words about Harvey. The left has gone away with, the left has gotten away with little to no mention of Democratic Senator Robert Menendez of New Jersey recently being indicted for corruption, or that the Anthony Weiner received a 21-month jail sentence for sexting messages to a 15-year-old. But now, Harvey Weinstein has been fired from his job due to sexual harassment charges and even accused of rape claimed by a plethora of women in Hollywood that have come forward to tell their horror stories about Weinstein. Weinstein, the sexual monster, was committing acts of rape and sexual misconduct while raising millions of dollars for Obama and the Hillary campaign, not to mention the hundreds of thousands of dollars he's given to the Clinton Foundation. According to the New York Times story and the New Yorker magazine article, he has been raking hell and havoc on the women in Hollywood, and most of the employees at Miramax and Weinstein Productions know it, including executives in Hollywood, actors and actresses. Even Meryl Streep called Harvey Weinstein God during one of her Oscar award speeches. Directors and lawyers knew, and the fake fraud media all knew and did nothing. And they all looked away because he was a liberal multi-million-dollar donor to the Democratic Party. A so-called open secret in Hollywood, he paid women to stop them from outing him. He made women and employees sign non-disclosure agreements, and he hired lawyers to suppress the truth. What a double standard by society, especially the fake media and all the Hollywood fakes. Let's talk all about it. Are we ready to talk about Harvey Weinstein? Go ahead, Alice. Give me some dirt.
I think Harvey Weinstein isn't worth very much of our time. I think what he does and what he doesn't do doesn't really affect our country, and the future of our country, and that's what I'm concerned with. I think it's worth discussing the double standard.
Oh, my God.
And we've had it on the Democrat, we've had it on the political side, and now we have it with the celebrities. We've always known it was there. It's just interesting that now it's like out of the closet, as it were.
Yeah.
And that's it. We have our president is dealing with very serious matters regarding our country and the future for us and our families and grandchildren, and that's where we should focus.
Well, I'm not getting Harvey off the hook.
Well, he's not off the hook, but he's not
Hollywood
much of our
time. Or the fake fraud media, they are not getting off the hook. Dolores Reyes is going to let you have it and rip you a new one. Are you ready? Everybody shut up and let's hear it. Are you ready? Mr. and Mrs. Hollywood, you are a piece of crap. You knew when you were trying to down
stay
Donald
in the light,
Trump.
Stay in the light.
Well, there, I don't see a light. I don't see a light. You, when you were down in Donald Trump for what he said on the bus, and you knew that Harvey Weinstein was raping women, committing all sorts of sex acts on women without their consent, and you, Meryl Streep, calling him God, and you, Hillary Clinton, had the audacity to take a $500 million from Harvey Weinstein that he raised. You guys are full of crap. You deserve everything that you've gotten. And the buck doesn't stop here. The person who wrote the article in the New Yorker magazine collaborated with NBC in the beginning. NBC, you know, when they saw his article, they started suppressing it. They told, he asked them to give him a crew because all these women were coming forward and he wanted to put them on TV and do a recording, etc. And NBC turned him down. NBC's president by the name of Oppenheimer told him, no, your article isn't ready. So he said, okay. He went and hired his own TV and production crew and interviewed all of the actors, actresses that came forward to him. And he took the article, walked it over to the New Yorker magazine, and the New Yorker magazine published it right away. You need to read the article. It reads like the Sidney Sheldon novel. It is horrifying, the things that Harvey Weinstein did, because he was a Democratic operative and because he had money and because he was white and because of all those other things that he got away with. But Mr. Weinstein...
Wait.
Hold on. Mr. Weinstein, you got away with it for all those years doing all those horrible things. And guess what else? A lot of executives over at NBC are quaking in their boots because they have been complicit. They hired all sorts of lawyers to go over there, and they told the board of directors of the Weinstein and Merrimack Studios that Weinstein was clear. He hadn't really done anything. All the issues had been taken care of. It was okay to keep him in the organization. Well, they all lied. They all knew. Are you guys familiar with the word honeypot?
No.
Do you know what a honeypot is?
No.
Well, I have other words for you. You know what a honeypot is?
Yeah.
The honeypots were the women that Harvey Weinstein would get in his organization to start out with at the meeting. You and I would, you know, I'm Harvey, you're you. We would go and sit at the meeting, and Alice is the unsuspecting starlet that he's getting ready to pounce on. So in order to make them feel comfortable, he would have a woman stand there at the meeting for the first 10 minutes. Then she would leave, and Harvey would be in the room with the young starlet all by themselves. And that's when he began to pounce. Why don't you rub my back with this oil? He actually came out and masturbated in front of one woman. Yes.
Dolores.
That's how horrifying it sounds. Well, that's what he did.
Wait a minute.
Excuse me. It is written in the New York Times, and it is on. It's in the article in the New Yorker. Who can get more conservative than the New Yorker? So it's okay to say it here on this particular show. I'm saying it, whether you like it or not. So, Harvey, I'm ripping you another one. I'm going to calm down because Alice is trying to make me calm down, so I'm going to calm down a little bit. But people in Hollywood are quaking in their boots, because they're not just Harvey, doesn't end there. It's going to get bigger, badder, and worse. Nikki, do you have anything to say?
I just see that it's opening the door to another can of worms, because he has friends, and the friends that he have are already in high places. So this is something that's bigger than Hollywood.
Absolutely.
And things like this, now they open the door to homosexuality being normalized. But when you start having a group of people that do heinous crimes, if we all going to say it's a normal thing, they might find a way to make this normal, because they're not being punished appropriately.
Well, you know, I think this is part of what has happened to our society. When you take God out of our lives,
yes,
then you live with situational ethics. So it was all right because, mm-hmm, right? But as far as I'm concerned, you know, we all knew what was going on, and
does that mean we're all complicit if we all knew and say anything about
it?
Does it mean we're complicit if we're a part of the problem? If you are not a part of the solution, then you are part of the problem.
Right.
Oh,
so
absolutely.
What is the solution?
I mean, we're definitely the problem, because we're the we're the funding source for Hollywood. We watch the movies. We go to the shows.
Nikki, you got them. You got
them.
You
know,
so we are the problem. So in order to go against them, you will have to actually reject Hollywood.
Yeah. Absolutely.
And what it produces.
Absolutely. And now this is for the first time those liberal left-wing nuts are actually coming forward and saying, okay, our jobs are pretty crappy too. We have still got the casting couch of the 40s. So, and that march on Washington they did against President Trump, calling him all sorts of names, now you got to swallow it, don't you? So, I'm thinking to myself, this is your comeuppance. You knew that this was going on and you were complicit and you are part of the problem too. And you try to attack our president under those conditions, call him all sorts of names, wearing all sorts of these little pink hats things at the march, and we all knew what that stood for. And you all along knew that this Harvey Weinstein and his company went along with it and his employees went along with it. Everybody knew he was this way. Yeah. It's your turn now. Let's see how you react
you
to
know,
this.
You know, again, it's get it back to sort of a better level. For me, this is, you know, that's the dark side. And this is the darkness. And this is the light
that's being shined on it.
And so it's a good thing. It's a good thing that this is happening right now.
NBC, they're coming for you, too. You were complicit. You tried to suppress the story. And the man went to the New Yorker and they published it. And kudos to the New York Times. Now, listen, I'm not a fan of the New York Times. I wouldn't spend one half of a penny on that paper. But at least they came forward with the story to solidify the information with the gentleman who actually wrote the New Yorker article. So in that regard, okay, you did a good thing. Now let's see what happens from this point moving forward. Anybody else have anything to say about Mr. Feinstein,
well,
Harvey Feinstein?
I think maybe you've beat him up enough for this.
I don't think he's been beat up enough. I really don't. I think that just because you have money and power, you shouldn't be able to take advantage of people.
Oh,
it
absolutely.
Takes me back in my head to a time when my ancestors weren't free in this country, how they were oppressed. Basically, he was almost oppressing these women, trying to take their jobs and ruining their careers, and because he couldn't have their way with them, or they told him no. I mean, this is in a bad place, in my opinion.
My ancestors were oppressed too. They were
absolutely
indentured servants.
Worldwide slavery is still one of the number one.
Does that not make you go back in your head of the days when women couldn't do anything?
I think it's a catch-22, because if those women were in the situation where they couldn't do stuff, they wouldn't have found themselves in that situation with that man. So some things is like a catch-22.
Absolutely.
Yes. I mean, it depends who you are, how you've been raised, what your values are. I had a situation when I was like 19 years old with the chairman of the company I was working for, and he was the chairman promising me this, that, and the other. And, you know, I've never even told anyone. It's just coming out of my mouth now.
Oh, good.
But I knew who I was. I knew what my values were. So I didn't have to do or comply.
And I have had a person actually back me up against a wall. And I was like, wait a minute. Wait. What's going on here? You know, this is before I was married. I've had men when I used to be an account executive, I've had men to say and approach me inappropriately. And some of them don't care what your morals or what your values are. They can overpower you. And there have been many women who've been overpowered. And not only physically, emotionally, mentally, physically, the whole nine yards. There have been women who have been overpowered, and this is what Harvey Weinstein did. When you look at him, you don't see his stature. Obviously, he was a big man. He wasn't little. He's about his height. How tall are you?
5'11".
Maybe somewhere around there. And he was big. I mean, no, he was big and tall. And you know how Hollywood people are. Yep. They're on a diet. They weigh 90 pounds, don't they? 96 pounds, most of them. Some little skinny thing. And he was just overpowering them, not only with his power, but with his physical power. So,
let's agree he's a dirtbag, right?
Yes, we agree he's a dirtbag. And so are a lot of the people in Hollywood, yes. Yes, double standards, absolutely.
Okay, now can we talk about the wonderful things our wonderful president is doing?
No. Okay. Let's talk about the military buildup. Okay.
Oh, I love the military.
Yeah. You want to talk about the military? Who wants to talk about the military? Go ahead, talk about the military buildup.
I think it's amazing what he's doing. I have a son who's active duty, a husband who's a retired veteran, and I'm very involved in many ways, both with active duty and with veterans. And there is such great morale now in the military because they know that good things are coming. They've had to work with equipment that was outdated and broken, and in the Air Force they had to go to museums to get parts for the planes. It was mm-hmm. just ridiculous. And so when you say, why is he trying to build up our military? One reason: to protect this country. A strong military is what we need, not to go to war, but to prevent war.
Absolutely.
And also to, if you're doing a job and you don't have the equipment that you need to do the job well, that's very demoralizing.
Yeah.
And so our troops know now that they have a commander-in-chief who is 100% behind them. And I'm just waiting and hoping that there's going to be a big increase in pay for our military, because I think those young men who go to war and put their lives on the line, and really is a pittance. So
I think the president in his 2018 budget did put in funds for them to have an increase in their pay. Mm-hmm. But no matter how much you pay them, they're still not enough. You know, I think that they are just absolutely, the armed forces in this country is just absolutely stellar. Nikki, I want you to say something before I start talking about, because you have a son in the military. So and
let's, I do too.
Yes, you mm-hmm. do too. Both of you do. And I don't. So... please say something before I start telling about the statistics of what the president has in mind.
Oh, no, I'm just very proud of the people that are standing and representing the country, and, you know, just taking that responsibility and not turning their backs on the country for any whatever personal beliefs or anything like mm-hmm. that. So I take my hat off to those young men and young women who fight for our country.
Absolutely. The president has asked Congress to eliminate the defense sequester, or the sequester that's on the Department of Defense. If anyone doesn't know what the sequester is, it's the budget, but you take part of the budget and you move it to the side, or you sequester it and not allow them to spend the money at all. And so during the Obama administration, all of the government agencies, except for the Veterans Administration, had a sequester of their funding. And that funding process actually went forward even to today. So the president has asked Congress to eliminate the defense sequester, almost like they have done with the Veterans Administration. Now, the president's goal is to build the Army forces up to 540,000 troops, which is a little more than $500,000, right. $500 million, actually. He wants the Marine Corps to have 36 battalions. His goal for the Navy is to increase the force to about 350 mm-hmm. surface ships and submarines. The Air Force goal is to increase its fleet of fighter planes to 1,200. The president's proposed budget for 2018 is to shift $54 billion to the Pentagon and military, which represents 10% of the budget. Increase Homeland Security by 7% and increase nuclear weapons by 11%. He proposes to increase military spending to about $800 billion. Okay? Now, why are we ramping up? Well, just like I've said in the past, we're in five different conflicts. Firstly, the most important I have written here is jobs, 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 education, and financial gain for all Americans. Training through military participation appears to be what the economic direction for our country is being centered around the military. We are in five conflicts around the world: Iraq, Syria, Afghanistan, Libya, and Yemen. We are constantly being threatened by Kim Jong-un, and who knows what Putin may do. We must defeat ISIS and its satellite organizations throughout the world. We must protect Americans from terrorist acts, and not to mention the inner cities of America, Trailer Park, Latino Barrio, and the ghetto need law and order from multinational gangs, human trafficking, murders, and drugs. So we do need to build up just about everything that deals with the defense and the security of our nation. Anybody else want to say anything? Please
Well,
do.
I think it's, you know, it's just amazing that our president is addressing all of these issues. And apart, you know, every day he's being bashed and beaten up, and he just keeps on keeping on.
Yes.
And, you know, just behind the scenes up there in the White House, he's working. I think he works so hard.
Yes, yes, and he looks good, too. He looks good.
Yes,
he doesn't look tired or haggard.
He is able to, what I call, stay in the light and keep focused on what his goals are. And I really do believe that by the time it comes to re-electing him, it will be a total landslide, because everyone will see the improvements and will see him for who he is and what he is doing for this country.
Absolutely. I think he's an energizer bunny. He hardly sleeps. He's up tweeting all hours of the night. He is so hopped up for this job. I do think he's the right person at the right time for this time. And I think that his concept of building the military at the foundation for jobs and for education and for training, particularly technical training. I was at a cybersecurity event yesterday at the museum. And if you haven't been in the museum, it's a beautiful place. And the technology, they were saying that they need so many people for these very highly skilled positions. And they're going to have to come up with a way to come up with that. Mm-hmm. And the military can provide that level of training.
I think there are 40,000 cybersecurity jobs,
that go unfilled,
vacant,
and they can't have, and they call for top. Some of them call for top security clearance or just security clearance, and they can't have people from foreign countries filling those jobs. So they're going to have to reach out to the barrio, the Latino barrio, the ghetto, and the trailer park in order to get people to come in here and train them and help them be a part of the new, someone called it a new industrial revolution at the event yesterday. And I was like, oh, wow, that's interesting. But it's cyber in view and scope and perspective. Okay. Anybody else have anything to say about our military and the buildup of our military by the president?
That, to me personally, even though my son is a part of the military, that's kind of scary to me in a sense, because the American population is only about 306 million more. And if one-third of the United States population becomes militarized, then that's like almost one military per person. It seems like that's how they lock us into like
a police state. 500,000?
But we already have troops and have, think a lot of things they've been, as far as like with the military, they're going into the regular police, local and city state levels, and they're militarizing them. So with that, increasing that, and also an increase in the military, it just seems like they're heading to more towards a police type of state.
Well, I don't see it that way.
I don't see it that way,
but what? If at this time in our history, being a part of the African-American community and the Latino community, I can see where we need some policing, maybe beyond policing. Because just the other day, MS-13 dragged a man out of his car and shot him in the head in broad daylight right in Maryland.
Yeah.
I mean, they're finding dead bodies of Latino men buried over in Virginia. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're getting out of control. When I go over to my husband's country, it is an absolute horrifying situation. So these are multinational gangs. It's a kind of gang system that we're not used to in this country. It's totally different. And we need military tactics and devices to get them under control, to get them out of our country or something, because they are out of control. I'm telling you right now, it is not a picnic. Go into some of the Latino communities and talk to some of the Latino people. They actually wait for their children outside of classrooms.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
To try to hurt them or do them in or make them join their gang. They're stealing women. I mean, this is getting really bad. It's a level of gangs that we're just not used to in this country. So our response is going to have to step up. And all these threats we're being faced with a lot of threats. And we're going to have to be vigilant. And maybe, just maybe, the future is that we will be a more militarized country.
Yeah,
it could really be the case. And maybe we really need it. I mean, the situation is changing. It's a dynamic change. I can see that something is going to happen. Something is going to be changing this country in a direction. And I'm just not sure what it is. But I think we need to be able to respond no matter what the threat may be. What are you thinking,
Alan? Well, I think we have our Constitution, and our president will always abide by our Constitution. And, you know, there will be tactics or strategy that has to be used to keep us safe, because that's the goal. To keep our country safe and to keep us safe.
I mean, there are people who want to make us afraid and run under the table and scared to go to a concert and don't go. You can't go to a movie and we can't go to shopping malls and we can't. They want our country to be like theirs.
We're not going
to
have troops on the street and...
Eventually they will. I mean, this is like single-handedly. I mean, I believe that some of this stuff is more of a dastardly plan. Because if I over-inundate the streets with gang members, if I have an ultimate plan to control... That's what I would do. I would make you want more military. I'm going to give you what you're asking for. Not to say that it's a good thing. I'm going to cause a scenario to make you want something that's going to, in the end, take away your rights and your ability to truly choose. And that's, I think, that is something else brewing underneath the surface.
Oh, you think there's something else brewing underneath
the because it's like a global epidemic.
But we'll have to wait and see. I just know when I visited foreign countries and I was in Spain, they had troops all over the place at the hotels. Then when I was in Mexico, they had troops on hotel rooftops. Mm-hmm. I was like, oh, God, this is interesting. You know, but they were there to protect both Spain and in Mexico. They were there to protect the tourists and the people in their economy is predicated, a lot of their economy, not all of it, most of their economy is predicated on tourists coming there. And they were there to protect the tourists. It's like, you know, you're not going to come to this 5-star hotel and cause any problem. These people spend the money in this country. So they had, this is the first time I saw like a machine gun when I was in Spain. I mean, the man had it on his shoulder in his uniform. They were standing all around our hotel and in Mexico the same way. So I kind of understand that there's a fine line between both, between protection and being overly, you know, overly zealous here. So I hopefully we can find that balance. And if we don't, oh well, we're just going to have to deal. Okay.
Our Constitution will always protect us.
Well, then, you know, they're trying to go after that, too.
Yes.
They're trying to go after our Constitution, but we have to be steadfast on that.
We're talking about the president that's in, you know, he is always going to protect our Constitution.
Absolutely, and maybe Ruth Ginsburg is going to be leaving the Supreme Court, so we can get another conservative appointed to that slot to make sure that our Constitution is not threatened. Okay, on Thursday, President Trump signed an executive order. The executive order gives millions of Americans relief from Obamacare. Does anybody want to talk about that first?
Well, I said hooray, the first nail in the coffin of Obamacare. And look what it's going to do. You know, it's going to open up cross-state insurance being able to buy.
What he promised.
Across state lines.
Exactly.
What he promised. And again, it's just a first step, but it's a step in the right direction.
Absolutely.
And we'll give the ordinary person some relief from what they have now. I mean, there are, is it 20 million people who have no insurance right now as a result of Obamacare?
Well, this executive order allows people, if you're between a job, you can still buy a health care plan that is very cheap. In other words, that health care plan doesn't have to meet all the conditions that were in the Obamacare plan. Also, if you are now 27 and you're no longer on your parents' health care plan, then you can also buy this very inexpensive policy across state lines so that you can have insurance because you're no longer under your parents' plan. The parents' plan stops at 26. So if you're 27, you're a young adult, you don't have it, you can go ahead and purchase this inexpensive plan and you can purchase it across state lines. So if Idaho has a plan that's good, that's cheaper, then you don't have to buy the one from New York.
That's right. So, if you're 75 years old, you don't have to buy insurance for birth control.
Absolutely. So and all those other things. So that's a good thing. Anybody else want to tell us anything else about the executive order, the wonderful executive order he signed yesterday?
Step in the right direction.
Step in the right direction. Yes. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Okay. Now we're going to talk about Rex Tillerson.
Tillerson, yes. Our Secretary of State.
Well, does anybody know what Rexit is?
He's
Rexit.
Rexit.
Yeah, Rexit. Does anybody know what Rexit is? No.
No.
Rexit. It's a term in Washington circles of a death watch that you're getting ready to leave your job. And they have pinpointed Rexit to mean that Secretary Tillerson is the Rexit person.
Oh, God.
Almost like Brexit.
It's like Brexit.
He is on his way out.
No.
This is what they're saying.
General Kelly came on.
I'm talking about Rex Tillerson. Because of all of the chatter, they've coined this new word called Rexit. So there you go. We're going to talk about, go ahead, Alice. So talk a little bit about.
Okay, well, Secretary Tillerson is, he was the CEO of Exxon, and he's an amazingly competent person. And he's a businessman like President Trump. And, when we hear about, they had a disagreement and he said this and he said that, we're just a little small podcast, or is that what you would call us? And you're the boss, and we have disagreements, right? So,
Absolutely. Of
course, everyone has disagreements.
Absolutely.
And that doesn't mean that they don't get along, and that he isn't doing a great job. So I really ignore all of that chatter.
Yeah. Well, I'm going to tell you some things about Mr. Tillerson. Okay.
It's a good.
And Mr. Tillerson, it appears that Tillerson's left-wing thinking may be in opposition to our president. Tillerson was the executive of the Boy Scouts. It was under his leadership that the Boy Scouts embraced membership for gays in the organization. He was to the left of the president on the Paris Accord. It was under Tillerson's leadership at Exxon that ExxonMobil accepted the climate change science philosophy. And he started making Exxon do things to in support of climate change theory for Exxon.
I think Tillerson, he may have been forced into that.
Pardon? This is when he was the CEO of Exxon.
Right.
So I guess the Democrats forced him into it. He's definitely in the wrong camp. Let me finish. Tillerson originally supported Jeb Bush for president and gave Jeb Bush the maximum allowed contribution an individual can give to a presidential candidate. Wagging tongues in Washington say he fights with the White House over personnel, and witnesses have seen the public spectacle of he and Trump differing on policy issues such as the fate of the Iran nuclear deal, which the president is going to address this nation about today. Leaders in the State Department and the White House chatter saying he is ineffective and he has few admirers in Congress. He has stated privately to several senators that he, Tillerson, thinks the State Department is way too big and has too much money. He decided not to spend nearly $80 million allocated to fight terrorist propaganda and Russian disinformation. He appears to be fine with all the senior level vacancies. Chatter is that he does not like the job and is just trying to stay afloat and counting the hours until he can make a graceful exit. There you go for Mr. Rexit.
Well, that's very interesting.
Absolutely.
And time will tell.
Absolutely. Anybody else have anything to say about Mr. Rex Tillerson?
Well, I would just say the president is in charge, and they'll thrash things out. And if it comes time for Mr. Tillerson to exit, he will exit gracefully.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Okay. Now, one other thing about Mr. Tillerson, when people are saying that he's ineffective, they claim that he really doesn't like the job. So I guess we'll see what happens. I know the president did say that once he talks about the Iranian deal, that there was going to be something that was going to hit the fan. Remember, he said all hell is going to break loose. So maybe that's what he's talking about. I think he's in total opposition to Tillerson. And
well,
I think that Tillerson
I think exactly the same thing has been said about General Kelly. And he came out yesterday.
Yeah, well,
he came out yesterday and he set all that straight.
Well, no. I heard the news conference. I don't think the chief of staff at the White House exonerated Tillerson at all.
No.
Oh, he exonerated himself.
Yes.
Well, Kelly is different.
A lot of this may just be chatter, and as he pointed out, you know, the press needs to get better sources, because a lot of this is coming from lower-level employees who really don't know anything, and some of them are holdovers, and some of them are not loyal to the president. So, you know, I think we always need to stay focused on what the president is doing and not get off track, because we can get sidetracked with all of this nonsense.
Sure, we could get sidetracked, but sometimes chatter has a foundation to it.
Yeah, true.
And just because the president hasn't attacked him like he did Sessions at this point, doesn't mean that he's unhappy with the job, and that the people who work with him over at the State Department feel
that he feels
he's isolated. He isolates them. He doesn't communicate well with them. There's just a whole thing going on with this Mr. Rexit.
Also got to understand that I would say 90% of the people at the State Department are Democrats.
I would go along with that. Yes. Mm-hmm. Well, based on what I've been reading about Tillerson, that he is too.
He's a
Democrat too.
I don't think so.
Well, I think he is. You know, I think Rhino's a Democrat. Actually, they just have Republican written on their shirt. But
no.
You think you don't think Rhinos are Democrats?
No, absolutely not. I think philosophically they are.
I think they are. Wait a minute. I'm gonna have to take your conservative credentials. So I'm gonna have to take your conservative credentials and throw them down the toilet.
I know a lot of them, and they just have a different viewpoint, a different way of approaching.
Okay. They just have a different way of telling us that we're crap. Okay. No. Well, anyway, we only have a couple of minutes left.
Yeah.
I am going to say this before we get everyone. Rapists and liars and hiders, oh my. It seems that Washington, D.C. isn't the only place that needs to drain the swamp. Hollywood appears to have a swamp that has a lot of swamp creatures swimming around in their waters, too. It appears that the fake characters in Hollywood aren't necessarily on the screen. So, with that, Alice, please give us a few words of wisdom,
as I always say to you, let's stay in the light. It is the only way to live our lives. It's the only way to approach any problem in our lives. And it is the only way that we can really help our president by shining the light on him for his protection and his wisdom and his good judgment. And thank God for this great country that we have, and that in spite of all our faults, he is still shining his light upon us.
Great. This is the Dolores Reyes Show. Reach out and talk to me on elifemedia.net. Talk to me on Facebook at Dolores Reyes. Send me a tweet and join our conversation on Fridays at 12:30. Call in at 240-455-5934. May God be the glory. Say amen to his majesty and grace. And thank you.